Good morning, everyone. Again, my name is Crystal McDonald, and I'm the Energy Policy Advisor within the Weatherization and Intergovernmental Programs Office here at the Department of Energy. And I know weatherization is in the title of our office, but we do more than just weatherization assistance programs. We work with state energy offices around the country, and we also work actually with every sector, every aspect of the public sector, that state government, local government, and I work specifically with K-12 school districts around the country. I do lead the K-12 education sector in the Better Buildings Challenge. The challenge was launched by the president in 2011, and it's a voluntary recognition program. It was a call to action to every sector of our economy, and that includes industrial folks, commercial folks, and everyone in the public sector, including K-12 school districts. And the call to action was to reduce your energy consumption by 20% over a 10-year period. And that's a challenge for a lot of our organizations. And so what we do is we spend time looking for those leaders to pull out success stories and best practices so that we can share them across the country. Our country is spending about $80 billion, that's billion with a B, in energy costs on an annual basis. So we partner with participants in the challenge to track and reduce their water use across their buildings and their infrastructure portfolio. And through this program, we create and we share real results, real solutions, and pathways so that others can replicate successes. Okay. I'm currently working with about 25 public school districts across the country. They're not all represented here, but we have representation from urban, suburban, and rural or small school districts, and that gives us a great diversity into the portfolio of scale. You know, what works in different building sizes and school district sizes, depending on where you're located, so geographic diversity is important to us, as well as size diversity. And we look at what is achievable at various levels. So some of our regional partners include Anne Arundel County Public Schools in Maryland. Are you guys familiar with Anne Arundel County? There's a huge mall there. And then there's Fairfax County Public Schools in Virginia. And then we have some DC public schools is a part of the city commitment to the challenge. And just by show of hands, I'm just curious about who's in the audience. Are you from Maryland, Virginia, DC? If you're from Virginia, raise your hand. Oh, okay. Great. And then anyone from Maryland here or the district? Okay, very well. Good deal. I was just curious because I was pulling some regional examples for my presentation today. So look at this word cloud. Why do we care? Why do we care about building energy efficiency? Energy efficiency has the potential to redirect significant savings back to educating students while establishing a safe, healthy, and productive environment for learning. Can anyone guess how much money we spend just in public schools alone on energy costs? I mentioned $80 billion across the nation. $79 billion? Who said $8 billion? You were right on the mark. We spend $8 billion in our public school systems just on utility costs. Now imagine if a fraction of those expenses went back to your classroom, to your teachers, taking wonderful field trips, getting some really cool technologies. And so we're looking at ways to save energy and to save cost in our school buildings. And it's an expense that can be reduced to free up educational resources. And so we do have a unique opportunity not only to save money, but to use schools as living laboratories where you can implement and install technologies that reduce energy, and also use the data that's collected from those technologies and strategies in your science, technology, engineering, and math courses. And so the Better Buildings Challenge recognizes these benefits within the K-12 school districts, and so we work to help them overcome financial, technological, and market barriers that are unique to K-12 school districts. The other thing I wanted to mention about our partners who are working with us, our K-12 school district partners who are working with us in the challenge, is that they're working with us to address things like interior and exterior lighting, energy management information systems. Do we have any like computer IT experts in the room? Do you like working with data, software? Okay, we'll get there, and I'll show you the importance of data. Fleet conversion, school bus fleets that have been converted. Zero energy buildings, and that was explained to you just a few minutes ago. Advanced plug-in process loads. You know, when you leave the room, do turn the light out. Or when you leave the room, do turn the computer off. But we now have advanced power strips that were that was developed in our one of our laboratories that can be centrally controlled and just switched off from a central computer to save money. But we also do things around workforce training and development. And of course, we make the connection with you guys through our ongoing workshops, competitions, and events in not just K-12, but in higher education as well. So without a basic understanding of energy, energy resources, generation, use and conservation strategies, individuals and communities cannot make informed decisions on topics ranging from smart energy use at home and consumer choices to national and international policy. So our current national and global issues such as the fossil fuel supply and climate change highlight the need for energy education. And the Department of Energy, actually, we've developed a framework for energy literacy to help consumers learn to trace energy flows and think in terms of energy systems, know how much energy you use and what you use it for, and then where it comes from. And then we also communicate about energy and energy use in meaningful ways. And on the left side of the screen, these are just a few uses of energies that we see in a typical commercial building, and then the percentages are specific to K-12 schools. So a lot of energy goes into making your environment comfortable, the space heating, lighting, cooling, ventilation so that we could have good air quality, water heating, computers, refrigeration, and of course cooking for your cafeteria and office equipment. Do you see any of those energy uses that are listed where you can make an impact, where you can turn off a switch in school? Great. So we can reduce energy to mitigate the impacts of climate change through energy efficiency. Climate change is real. And there's something we can do about it in our buildings. Now here's an example of McKinley High School in Northeast Washington. McKinley was originally constructed in 1926. This building has been through many iterations of modernization and repairs over the decades. The most recent modernization efforts created a high-tech academic space for students in STEM fields with state-of-the-art technologies for academic use throughout the building. So, let's see, did I pass the picture? There's a picture of the building. I'm not sure if you're familiar with this building, but it's been modernized, but pretty much the same construction as it has always been since 1926. And here's the energy use profile for McKinley Tech. Energy data was collected to create this energy use profile for McKinley. Can anyone guess why we are interested in collecting data on energy for a particular school? Any benefits that may come from this? This is a graph where we plot the energy use over the course of one day. So you can see when the students and staff begin to arrive at school. Everyone's at school in the middle of the day, and then it tails off probably for evening activities. The process of collecting and analyzing utility data is called benchmarking. And some of the benefits of energy benchmarking include managing energy use properly and proactively. We assess and compare buildings' energy performance. We identify billing errors and other anomalies. The Philadelphia Public School District, they did a utility analysis. They looked at this kind of data across all of their schools. Guess how much money they discovered that they were overpaying the utility company? $1 million. That's a lot of money for errors in your utility bill. So it's very important to look at this data. We also look at this to assess the effectiveness of current operations, policies, and practices. And it also helps to set goals and targets for reducing energy efficiency. So look at these numbers, and I'm going to do a side-by-side comparison with McKinley and my next example. Dunbar High School is located in Northwest Washington, D.C., not far from here. It was established in 1891 and became America's first public high school for African American students. Needless to say, Dunbar has occupied at least 3 to 4 buildings over the past century. And this is the newest building, which just opened a little over a year ago, I would say. And the building opened with a 463 kilowatt solar panel installation. This installation is the largest rooftop solar panel array in the district. And it helped Dunbar receive the highest LEED certification score for an American high school. In other words, energy efficient and renewable energy technologies are incorporated in the design and operation of this building. And let's take a look at Dunbar's energy use profile. I downloaded the data for both schools, and by the way, due to the policies that the Department of Energy has supported, a lot of cities are adopting benchmarking disclosure policies. That means all public buildings will have energy use profiles so that the public can view how energy is being used and where taxpayer dollars are going. So I downloaded the data for both McKinley and Dunbar on the same day. McKinley's energy use peaked at around 650 kilowatts. Dunbar's energy use peaked around the same time at about 375 kilowatts. Imagine the hundreds and thousands of dollars that represents. And the public benchmarking site for DC is called buildsmartdc.com. And you should check in your city and county to see if there's one available for you to look at. And I like the tagline of this website, more data, less carbon, zero excuses. So here's a side-by-side comparison of McKinley and Dunbar. And keep in mind, Dunbar has this huge solar panel array on its rooftop. And look at the differences. The building square footage is about the same, but look at the energy use intensity. And I know that's a big term right now, but just look at the numbers. The lower your energy use intensity, the better. On average, the energy use intensity for schools in the US are about 100. So if you get below 100, that's good. But we're striving to get to 25 at least. So we're getting there. And look at the annual costs. And these are just for 2 high schools in the district. Imagine what your school district looks like. And then look at the annual greenhouse gas emissions in tons. So this just demonstrates the impact of energy efficiency on building energy use. The other takeaway from this comparison is just to think about your own homes. Think about spending the $1,500 your parents may spend on a utility bill compared to $500 by doing things like going from single pane windows to double pane windows, or moving from standard appliances to Energy Star appliances. Are you guys familiar with Energy Star refrigerators and TVs and all of that? And then going from like incandescent bulbs to compact fluorescent bulbs. So just think about how these principles can be applied to your daily life. clean energy future. We heard Janine talk about a clean energy future. And I mentioned today that climate change is real, and I believe that we can do something about it. And my job is to identify those school districts that have implemented these changes and advancing towards their clean energy goals, and then sharing that information with others. Each one reach one is what I believe. And we have a robust website. If you want to know more about particular projects that schools have done, you can visit the Better Building Solutions Center to see what school districts across the nation have done, not only in their building operations, but what students are doing as well. There's so much more to be done in this clean energy future. How can I make a difference? I enjoy what I do. I'm not sure if you can tell that, but I do enjoy what I do. Environmental stewardship has been one of my passions since I grew up as a Girl Scout, and we've always been concerned about the outdoors and our environment. And I'm fortunate that I'm able to turn my passion into a profession where I can make a difference in the energy world. It didn't happen overnight. It was an evolutionary process, which was triggered during my Dunbar days. So I was happy to use Dunbar as an example, actually. And at Dunbar, that's where I became interested in engineering. I earned my bachelor's in science in architectural engineering from North Carolina A&T State University, and that's in Greensboro, North Carolina. And then I came home and went back to school to earn my master's in energy and environmental management at the George Washington University. Are you guys familiar with George Washington University? Okay, great. And so I did my summer internships right here at Pepco in DC. So I've had various engineering positions and life experiences that have guided my interests and career pursuits. And so now I've been here with the Department of Energy for about 6 years. And I'm really happy and pleased with the work that I do. So just think about that as you're sitting in your science and math classes, there is an application for that. I know it may not all make sense, but it all does come together. Here's another word cloud. I love word clouds, by the way. And these are some terms that I think you're probably already familiar with. But here's my unsolicited advice when you're looking at this word cloud. Be curious. Be curious about energy. Be curious about our natural resources. Be curious about our national security and climate change. Be curious about the Paris Agreement and what it means to you and your family and this nation. And if you don't know what the Paris Agreement is, I encourage you to look that up. And be curious about how this is all interconnected. Then ask yourself, am I part of the solution leading toward a clean energy revolution? So I'm now at the end of my presentation. I thank you for your time and attention with this. And I'd like to leave you with these words. Energy efficiency is one of the easiest and most cost-effective ways to combat climate change, clean the air we breathe, improve the competitiveness of our businesses, and reduce energy costs for consumers. And the other piece that I like, that this was said by one of my colleagues at the Department of Education. She runs the Green Ribbon Schools program there. She says, these schools and districts are ensuring that their students learn to live, work, and play with sustainability and health in mind, not as an afterthought, but as an integral part of everything they undertake, from cradle to career. And so with that, I'd like to leave these parting words with you and conclude my presentation. I thank you for your time today, and happy Energy Awareness Month. Enjoy your visit.